Have you heard about clustering and wondering how it might be able to help you with your DNA? Well, I'm going to try to answer the question about what different methods of clustering are there today, and hopefully you can use one of those to help you with your DNA research. The way I look at it, there are three methods for clustering DNA matches. Now, three major methods. You can use different methods to cluster, but I think most of them are a variation on these three methods. And so that's what I wanted to go over today and show you an example of what the output of each one is and talk a little bit about why you would use each one. So let's get started with the first one. This is called the Leeds method or the shared matches. What you're trying to do here is we want to take the 90 centimorgan to 400 centimorgan matches that we have, and we want to sort and organize these into grandparent groups. In other words, which ones are related to our paternal grandfather, which ones are related to our paternal grandmother, as well as our maternal grandfather and our maternal grandmother. And this takes our matches and divides it up into four nice groups that we can then do research on individually. The nice thing about this method is it can be done with any platform as long as you can see matches and see which matches you share with other people. You can use this method. Let me show you what a Leeds chart looks like. Now, here is one that I use in teaching, and this one I've actually used even smaller than 90 centimorgans just because the number of matches for the data I didn't have enough in the 90 centimorgans and above. But what I've done is I've divided this up and I've color-coded each column for the people who match those people. And I've also listed some other information. For example, people that I know how they're related. You know, let's say what that relationship is. Sometimes there's people that I can see, hey, these are half brothers right here because of what information I've gathered from contacting them. And over the top, as these colors go through, I've put a little information about which grandparent they belong to. So PGF is my paternal grandfather, the Garnett line, and that is represented by these yellow ones down here. I have a couple that I know are from my maternal grandfather and my maternal grandmother, but then I have a couple other colors that I haven't determined quite yet where they are from, but I know they're on the maternal side. And so interestingly enough, the only grandparent I haven't identified in this list is my paternal grandmother and anybody that's related through her. Now, in this case, I used 23andMe information to create this. I've got a similar chart for this person from GEDmatch, from MyHeritage, as well as from Ancestry and FamilyTree DNA, because again, you can use any platform. This is one that you manually do, and I have a video on how to create a Leeds method chart using some different platforms that you can check out on our channel as well. So that is the Leeds method chart, and I call this a 1D clustering because you're using shared matches. You're just using one dimension really to create this cluster. The chart is flat in that way as far as the information that you read. Now we go to the next version, which I call a 2D cluster. And sometimes you might hear this referred to as an autocluster, or some people may refer to it as your shared matches. And what's interesting about this is you can actually expand a Leeds chart, a 1D cluster, into a 2D cluster simply by doing some more work and looking at all the matches instead of just the shared matches from one of those matches for that list. Now, with the autocluster, the nice thing about this is, first off, we can adjust the CM level, whereas with the Leeds chart, we try to keep between 90 centimorgans and 400 centimorgans so we can separate out those four grandparents. With an autocluster, we can be looking at clusters down to 20 centimorgans or even less if we need to. So it is used to identify groups with smaller shared match amounts than with the Leeds method. So for instance, with the Leeds method, the idea behind each one of those clusters of matches is they're related to one grandparent. Once we get into an autocluster with some of these, we are seeing maybe a cluster that's related to a great-grandparent or great-great-grandparent, or a great-great-great-grandparent, for that matter. Now, because of this, there's some more information that you need, and so you can't do this on every platform. You can use this on Genetic Affairs, you can use this on GEDmatch, and you can use this on MyHeritage with the AutoCluster. All three of those are licensed with the Genetic Affairs software that does the auto clustering. You can create your own 2D cluster from 23andMe and from MyHeritage and from Ancestry, but you have to do it manually. And a lot of people don't necessarily want to do that. Now, on Genetic Affairs, it can actually take information from Family Tree DNA and 23andMe and create that auto cluster for you. And I would highly recommend that if you're going to do clustering like this, then you want to use that automated stuff from Genetic Affairs. It will save you hours of time. Let's take a look at what this 2D clustering looks like. So this is from MyHeritage, and they send you a spreadsheet that looks like this, and you can actually see, hey, here is this box of this cluster. What you find is that the people down the side are the same people across the top. And so we're actually comparing everybody to everybody else. And that's how we get two-dimensional clusters, basically a box like this. As we go down, we can see that some of these clusters get smaller and smaller, where we might have clusters with just a few people in them. Here's a cluster with just really three people that are part of that. What I like about this is a couple of things. If we pair this with the leads method, what we can do is we can go through our list of people, and in that cluster we can see, hey, have we already assigned them on one of our leads chart to a certain grandparent? If so, well, then we know what line we are related to this group through, but this cluster might have a more distant common ancestor. Like I said, a great-grandparent, a great-great-grandparent. But instead of having to look at all of our family tree, now we can focus in on that particular grandparent line through that. So this type of clustering, again, we're going down to much smaller levels. You can see here 36 centimorgans. I think there might even be some 20, 25 centimorgans in here. And we're able to identify these people that all share, or most all of them share, some DNA in common with each other. So that is a two-dimensional cluster, or what is sometimes called an auto cluster, or the shared matches. And the third one is what I call matrix clustering, or a 3D cluster. And this is actually somewhat similar to the 2D cluster, but we're adding in a little bit more information. The idea behind this is we want to actually find clusters within clusters. So this can be done with GEDmatch primarily, using the matrix options. You can also manually do this with data from MyHeritage and 23andMe, because they give you the amount of DNA that you share. Doing this manually on 23andMe and MyHeritage can be time-consuming to set up. So let me show you what it looks like. Now, this is created from GEDmatch, and it looks somewhat similar, like I said, to a 2D cluster, in that we're seeing some boxes here, both small and large. But what has been added in that makes this three-dimensional is not just our matches, which is two-dimensional, but I've also put in how much DNA each one of these people share with that match. And so what's interesting about this is we can see some data. First off, let's take a look at this, and I see here that, hey, this one right here, they don't share much DNA with this whole group of people. So I'm actually going to move that one down. And whenever I move a row, I have to move the corresponding column as well. So now I have this big cluster right here that I want to look at. Now, these first two people happen to be my mom and her sister. And so that's really what we're looking at. We're looking at these clusters in relation to them. And I can see that they're sisters because of how much DNA they share, 2,600 centimorgans, which is right within siblings. So looking at this group right here, I actually see a couple of things. There is this cluster within this group, which includes a parent and a bunch of siblings. because all these people here, they all share in that 2300 to 2800 range, which is siblings. So there's four siblings, and they all share 3500 centimorgans roughly with this other person. So this person is their parent, and these four are siblings. But they're part of another cluster, which includes, it looks like, first cousins, great aunts or uncles, maybe a second cousin within there. So I've got this big family group, but I've got a really tight family group within it as well. And so that's what I mean by finding clusters of clusters. In other words, I could map out this cluster just with talking with one of these people. I know that there's four siblings. I know that there's one grandparent. And then I just need to figure out, okay, how are these other people related to them? So switching over to a 2D cluster, these numbers in here that MyHeritage gives you, this is just a number of the person. So this is person one, person two, person three. It's not how much shared DNA they have. So I can't tell how these people are related to each other within this cluster. But with a 3D cluster, I start to see how some of these people are related simply by the amount of shared DNA. Let me go down to this bigger cluster down here. And we can see this one is not as tightly knit together as that other cluster. There are a couple of parent-child relationships, as well as some more distant relationships. And we see what I've done is on the outside here, hey, these ones are the ones that are more distant than the others. They're in the just under 20 centimorgan range, while a lot of the ones in the middle here are in the 20s to 30s centimorgan range. Still not very much, but this is a much more loosely related cluster than the other one. And that's the nice thing about 3D clustering is you can start to see, hey, do I actually have one family group in here? Or do I have maybe even two family groups in here that are second cousins to each other that, you know, are third or fourth cousins to some other people around it as part of a cluster? I like 3D clustering because you can start to see some more information. Now, again, using the matrix function and GEDmatch, you can make one of these, and I have a video on that, and I have a spreadsheet that helps you to make that. But you can still do this with MyHeritage and 23andMe partially. It's time consuming to set up though, because for each one of those lists, there's hundreds of different connections that you're trying to get all of these shared DNA data points for. Now, clustering is a great way, any kind of clustering is a great way to find people through DNA because you're using some known relationships to help narrow down where you need to search. As you have new matches come up, they then can be added to the clusters that you've already found. And while they may not have a tree, because of this clustering and how everybody else is related, you might know how they're related to you as well. That particularly if they're adoptees where they don't know who one or both of their parents are, you may be able to help them solve that problem because they fit into a cluster that you know where that most recent common ancestor is. So if you haven't tried any of these clustering methods, I would recommend you start with the LEADS method because it's the easiest, and then go on to auto clustering. And finally, if you're ready to give that a little bit of a boost, you can do the matrix clustering as well. Now, if you'd like to learn how to do a LEADS method, you can check out this video up here. But if you want to learn something else about DNA, then check out this video down below.